see," said the vampire thoughtfully, and slowly he walked across the room towards the window. For a long time he stood there against the dim light from the Visitero Street and the passing beams of traffic. The boy could see the furnishings of the room more clearly now, the round oak table and chairs. A wash basin hung on one wall with a mirror. He set his briefcase on the table and waited. "But how much tape do you have with you?" asked the vampire, turning now so that the boy could see his profile. "Enough for the story of a life." "Sure, it is a good life. Sometimes I interview as many as 3 or 4 people a night, if I'm lucky, but it has to be a good story. That's only fair, isn't it?" "Admirably fair," vampire answered. "I would like to tell you a story of my life, then. I would like to do that very much." "Great," said the boy, and quickly he removed the small tape recorder from the briefcase, making a check of a cassette and the batteries. "I'm really anxious to hear the why. You believe this, why you?" "No," said the vampire abruptly. "We can't begin that way. Is your equipment ready?" "Yes," said the boy. "Then sit down. I'm going to turn on the overhead light." "But I thought vampires didn't like light," said the boy. "If you think the dark adds to the atmosphere." But then he stopped. The vampire was watching him with his back to the window. The boy could make out nothing of his face now, and something about the still figure there distracted him. He started to say something again, but he said nothing. And then he sighed with a relief when the vampire moved toward the table and reached for the overhead cord. At once, the room was flooded with a harsh yellow light, and the boy, staring up at the vampire, could not repress a gasp. His fingers danced backwards on the table to grasp the edge. "Dear God," he whispered. Then he gazed, speechless, at the vampire. The vampire was utterly white and smooth, as if he were sculptured from the bleached bone, and his face was seemingly inanimate as a statue, except for 2 brilliant eyes. vampire's full black hair. The waves that were combed back over the tips of the ears. The curls that barely touched the edge of the white collar. Now, do you still want to interview? The vampire asked. The boy's mouth wasn't open before the sound came out. He was nodding. Then he said, yes. The vampire sat down slowly opposite him and leaning forward said gently and confidently, don't be afraid. Just start the tape. And then he reached out over the length of the table. The boy recoiled, sweat running down on the side of his face. The vampire clamped a hand on the boy's shoulder and said, believe me, I won't hurt you. I want this opportunity. It's more important to me than you can realize now. I want you to begin. Then he withdrew his hand and sat collected, waiting. It took a moment for the boy to wipe his forehead and his lips with handkerchief, to stammer that the microphone was in the machine, to press the button, to say that the machine was on. You weren't always a vampire, were you? He began. No. Answered the vampire. I was 25 years old, man, when I became a vampire, and the year was 1791. The boy was startled by the preciseness of the date, and he repeated it before he asked, how did it come about? There's a simple answer to that. I don't believe I want to give simple answers. Said the vampire. I think I want to tell the real story. Yes, said the boy quickly. He was folding his handkerchief over and over, wiping his lips, now with again. There was a tragedy. The vampire started. It was my brother, younger brother. He died. And then he stopped so that the boy cleared his throat and wiped at his face again before stuffing the handkerchief almost immediately into his pocket. It's not painful, is it? He asked timidly. Does it seem so? Asked the vampire. No, it took. He shook his head. It's simply that I have only told this story to one another person, and that was long ago. No, it's not painful. We were living in Louisiana then. We received a land grant and settled two indigo plantations on the Mississippi, very near New Orleans. Oh, that's the accent, boy said softly. For the moment, the vampire stared blankly. I have an accent. He began to laugh. The boy, flustered, answered quickly. I noticed it in the bar when I asked you what you did for a living. It's just the slight sharpness in the consonants, not all. I never guessed it was French. It's all right, the vampire answered him. Not as shocked as I pretended to be. It's only that I forget it from our life there was both luxurious and primitive, and we ourselves found it extremely attractive. You see, we lived far better there than we could had ever lived in France. Perhaps the sheer wilderness of Louisiana only made it seem so. But seeming so, it was. I remember the imported furniture that cluttered the house. The vampire smiled, and the harpsichord that was so lovely, my sister used to play it on summer evenings. She would sit at the keys with her back the open French windows, and I could still remember that thin, rapid music and the vision of the swamp rising beyond her, the moss-hanging cypresses floating against the sky, and there were the sounds of the swamp, a chorus of creatures, the cry of the birds. The music more delicate and desirable. Even when the wisteria tore the shutters of the attic windows and worked its tendrils right into the whitewashed brick until less than a year. Yes, we loved it, all except my brother. I don't think I ever heard him complain of anything, but I knew how he felt. My father was dead then, and I was ahead of my family, and I had to defend him constantly from my mother and sister. They wanted to take him visiting and to New Orleans for parties, but he hated these things. I think he stopped going altogether before he was 12. Prayer was what mattered to him. Prayer and his leather-bound leaves of the saints, lives of the saints. Finally, I built him the oratory removed from the house, and he began to spend most of every day there, and often early in evenings. It was ironic, really. He was so different from us, so different from everyone, and I was so regular. There was nothing extraordinary about me whatsoever. The vampire smiled. Sometimes in the evening, I would go out to him and find him in the garden near the oratory, sitting absolutely composed on a stone bench there. And I would tell him my troubles and difficulties I had with the slaves, how I distrusted the overseer, or the weather, or any brokers. All the problems that made up the length and breadth of my existence. And he would listen, making only a few comments. was wrong. The memory stopped. For the moment, the boy only glanced at him, and then he started as if awakened from deep thought, and he floundered as if he could not find the right words. He didn't want to be a priest, the boy asked. The vampire studied him as if trying to discern the meaning of his expression. Then he said, I meant that I was wrong about myself, about not denying him anything. His eyes moved over the far wall and fixed on the panes of the window. He began to see visions, real visions. The boy asked, but again there was a hesitation, as if he were thinking of something else. I didn't think so, the vampire answered. It happened when he was 15. He was very handsome then. He had the smoothest skin and the largest blue eyes. He was robust, not thin as I am now and was then, but his eyes. It was as if when I looked into his eyes, I was standing alone on the edge of the world, on a wind-swept ocean beach. There was nothing but the soft roar of the waves. Well, he said, his eyes still fixed on the window panes. He began to see visions. He only hinted at this at first.